This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
وافقت الولايات المتحدة على بيع إسرائيل.
The U.S. has approved the sale of 25 F-35 fighter planes to Israel. The Pentagon estimated the cost at more than $15 billion.
وأضاف أن تل أبيب تحتاج إلى تلك الطائرات لتعزيز دفاعها الجوي.
The Pentagon added that Tel Aviv needs the aircrafts to strengthen its air defense system, with the first shipment arriving in 2013. The F-35 fighter is considered to be one of the most advanced warplanes in the world.
ستكون إسرائيل أول دولة في العالم يسمح لها بشراء طائرة الـF-35.
Israel will be the first country in the world to be allowed to acquire the F-35 fighter, or what Israel refers to as the stealth. 25 F-35 fighters will join the Israeli Air Force at the beginning of 2014. The aircraft is considered to be one of the world's most advanced fighter planes, and it enjoys a superb interceptive and bombing capability. The fighter also has short takeoff and vertical landing capabilities. According to some political analysts, the F-35 fighter plane is expected to give Israel an exceptional and strategic superiority over Iran.
تفوقاً نوعياً واستراتيجياً في مواجهة إيران كما يرى بعض المحللين السياسيين.
It is a way to strengthen Israel's bullying and bombing capabilities in the region during the upcoming years, especially after Israel failed in its war against Lebanon. The objective is to boost Israel's bombing capability in order to dominate the entire region, including all Arab countries and Iran.
تريد الولايات المتحدة إذن المحافظة على التفوق النوعي والاستراتيجي لإسرائيل حليفتها الأهم وهو ما من شأن
The U.S. wants to preserve the exceptional and strategic superiority of Israel, its most important ally. This may push the Middle East into an unprecedented arms race, thus putting the region on top of a barrel that is packed with gunpowder and that may explode at any time. The U.S.-Israeli deal comes 2 days after a report was issued confirming that Israel has received an advanced radar system that would provide early warning against an attack. The radar, which was set up in the Navatim military base in the Negev Desert, can detect incoming missiles that are launched within a 2,000-kilometer radius 13 minutes before reaching Israel. This will improve the capability of the Hetz interceptor missile, which is being jointly developed by the U.S. and Israel, in addition to other ground defense systems.
إلى جانب دفاعات أرضية أخرى.
The U.S. is a country we are maintaining a good relationship with. The U.S. and the Israeli military, in cooperation with Boeing, are working to develop the Hetz interceptor missile. The Magic Wand defense system is being developed in cooperation with the U.S.-based Raytheon company. Its purpose is to counter Katyusha rockets. Last month, Israel signed an arms deal with the U.S. The deal was estimated at $300 million. The deal includes GBU-39 bombs capable of piercing through concrete fortified bunkers. Elias Karam, Al Jazeera, West Jerusalem.
أهلا بكم إلى التفاصيل التي نبدأها من العراق حيث يبدأ أكثر من 100
The process of integrating more than 100,000 Sahwa Council forces into Iraqi institutions has started. The authority over these forces was transferred from the U.S. to the Iraqi government at the end of September. The first phase will include the transfer of 54,000 members to Baghdad. However, this issue raises a problem because the Sahwa Councils want their entire members to be integrated in the country's security agencies and in the army. The Sahwa Councils fought the Al-Qaeda organization and defeated it, and they enjoyed American support both in funding and weapons.
In an attempt to control the security situation in all Iraq, the Iraqi government managed to take over the authority from the United States of what is known as the Sons of Iraq or the Sahwa Council Forces. The Iraqi government is supposed to take over the responsibility of the 100,000 Sahwa Council Forces that were costing the United States $15 million a month. However, the Iraqi government said that it will only integrate 20% of them into the Iraqi police and army. The government is trying to integrate the rest in civilian jobs or pay them compensations for their efforts. In addition, the government will integrate 13,000 of the Sahwa Council forces under certain conditions. This step has generated mixed reactions in the Iraqi government. While some support integrating the Sahwa Council forces into the Iraqi security agencies, others are opposed to it.
We want the Iraqi government to deal with the Sahwa Council forces in a transparent way. The issue of integrating the Sahwa Council forces into the Iraqi security agencies is a must. These forces should not be integrated into the Iraqi police or army. We want them to be able to join military and police academies.
Transferring the authority over the Sahwa Council to the Iraqi government took place after Iraqi and American officials met with the leaders of the Sahwa Council and assured them that the Iraqi government will not abandon them. This came after some of the Sahwa Council members were accused of crimes such as kidnappings and killings. The government, however, reiterated that it will not abandon them and said that it will not make random arrests.
The government is serious in the way it deals with this sensitive and serious issue. The government policy is based on two important principles. One is the importance of integrating al-Sahwa forces into the Iraqi government as an appreciation for their actions and positions they've taken in supporting the political processes and security inside the country. The second principle is that the government policy must be transparent and specific in the way it deals with this issue.
The American Army said that they will monitor the Iraqi government's policy towards the Sahwa Councils, especially in Al-Azamiyya, Al-Dura, Al-Amriya, Al-Ghazaliya, and Al-Sayyida, districts that used to be described as the death zone. Based on what happens, the United States will decide on whether or not it will hand over the authority to the Iraqi government in provinces like Diyala, where Sahwa leaders warned that Al-Qaeda may return if their fighters are not integrated into the Iraqi security agencies. This is what the American forces are afraid of.
The Center of Cancerous Tumors in the province of Babel suffers from a lack of technical equipment to treat tumors, forcing Iraqis to travel to Baghdad for treatment, which may take many months. We leave you with this report from Iman Muhammad.
The Center of Cancerous Tumors in the province of Babel provides medical treatment for citizens living in the central Euphrates River area. According to the latest statistics by the center, they have treated 7,982 cancer victims through 2007. In the first half of 2008, 570 people were diagnosed with cancer. In the past 4 years, 1,852 people lost their lives in the province of Babel. Scientists believe that the spread of cancer is caused by the contamination of air, water, and soil during the wars in Iraq.
We have recorded 130 cases of cancer. The cases of cancer have increased from 88 in 1990 to 7,982 cases in 2008. This rapid increase in cancer cases was recorded in Babel, which serves all citizens in the central Euphrates.
The rate of cancer should not have changed, or it should have increased slightly. However, we noticed that the increase in number of cancer cases is alarming. In 2004, there were 500 cases. In 2007, however, there were more than 1,000 victims. There were 1,025 cases. The cases of cancer have doubled.
A large number of cancer patients are not receiving complete medical treatment due to lack of radiation therapy equipment, despite the many pleas. This has caused citizens to travel to Baghdad and wait for their turn to receive medical treatment, which may take several months. By then, the health condition of the patients deteriorates. This has forced both the citizens and doctors to call on the government to fix this system, like what was done in the Iraqi Kurdish
region.
The radiology hospital in Baghdad has only two machines. One is used in the mornings and the other is used at night. I started working at 6 p.m. and I leave at 6 a.m. We also have shortages of necessary substances during the evening shifts.
The people suffer greatly by having to seek medical treatment outside Iraq. One needs 5 million dinars to go to Iran or Syria to receive 1 month worth of radiation therapy. If we have this equipment, we would have a lot of money, 5 million plus 5 million plus 5 million. We can buy the equipment and treat cancer cases with radiation, just like the provinces in northern Iraq. One similar machine is in Mosul, another in Erbil, Al-Sulaymaniyah, and there are two old ones in Baghdad.
The failure to provide the Babil Cancerous Tumor Center with radiology equipment adds a new burden on Iraqi patients, leaving them in need of someone to take notice of their suffering. From the Center of Cancerous Tumors, Babil, Imam Muhammad Al-Sumaria.
The rift in the relationship between the religious constituencies and the secular majority in the Israeli entity continues to grow to a point beyond repair. Olmert's latest remarks, in which he admitted of the collapse of the Zionist dream, didn't help clear the haziness surrounding this relationship. Therefore, the implementation of the theory in which the Zionist ideology was based on is no longer valid. The following report was prepared by the Israeli Channel 1.
Shortly after midnight, Professor Ziv Sternhell went outside his home to close the main gate when a small pipe bomb exploded. The professor, who was hit by shrapnel, sustained injuries extending from his lower foot to his upper thigh.
The professor is in good condition and he is conscious. He is able to smile and talk, and he will remain in the hospital until he recovers and is able to go home.
The Israeli police found dozens of leaflets that were left at the scene offering a 1 million shekel reward to anyone who kills a member of Israel's Peace Now movement. The leaflet further said that Israel has been turned into a ghost state seized by evildoers who are trying to replace God's laws and oppose the construction of settlements in the West Bank.
The painful incident that took place yesterday reminds us of the attack on Amer Greenspan and the assassination of Rabin. In my opinion, the security forces, Israel's national security advisor, the Israeli government, as well as the legal system, have all failed to deal with the growing sentiment of fascism in Israel.
Meanwhile, a special internal investigation team was formed inside the Israeli police, and this is what one Israeli thinker had to say about the classification of identities.
If our identity becomes an occupier's identity, then I will give it up.
The pipe bomb that was detonated at the home of Sternhell was described as small, but it could have caused more harm to the professor. A few months ago, Professor Sternhell received insulting and vulgar messages at his apartment. According to sources, infiltrating the radical right wing is very difficult, and the investigation may take a long time to complete.
I will not condemn the attack on the professor. However, we must condemn the security agencies for failing to prosecute the professor for his peculiar statements, which creates a vacuum that leads to these types of actions.
This action violates state laws and contradicts the principles of Judaism and must be condemned.
The perpetrators were aware that Professor Sternhell was scheduled to be outside the country for 2 weeks, and the explosion took place on the eve of his return to Israel. Meanwhile, the security agencies fear that more leftists may be targeted, which explains the reason behind assigning a police patrol unit outside the home of Secretary General of the Peace Now movement, Yariv Oppenheimer. Are they going to assign security officers around your home?
The police have not told us what to do. I don't know, but we'll talk to the police.
Now that international economic sanctions seem to have failed at slowing Tehran's nuclear weapons development, how should Israel respond? That's the question IBA's Jonathan Elkins put to MK Dr. Yuval Steinitz, the former head of the Knesset Foreign Affairs and Defense Committee.
I think it was clear from the outset that sanctions alone will not do. Also with Libya, what really worked is not the sanctions or the diplomatic isolation, but the very tough military ultimatum given by United States and Britain. The same goes to Iran as well. Only brute force, or alternatively, a very clear, strong American military ultimatum, very reliable ultimatum by America, might help to change the Iranian minds.
But unfortunately, you don't really have an American president who can do that. On the one hand, you have a lame duck president who doesn't have the power or the wherewithal or the mandate to make such an ultimatum. On the other hand, we don't really know what the two candidates will do once they get into office, do we?
Well, it's always difficult to predict, you know, but I will risk predicting. I know McCain very well. I spoke with him several times about Iran, face to face. I never met face to face with Obama, but I know some of his advisors and I heard his rhetoric. I think both of them are very clear. And contrary to the common wisdom, I will not be surprised if a few months after the new administration will be established, after either McCain or Obama are taking place.
Obama has said that he will negotiate with the Iranians, that he won't attack.
Obama was very explicit. He said he will give very limited time, few months, not more, for tough negotiation. If this will fail, everything will be considered, including the military option. McCain always, I remember my first meeting with him already at September 2003, was very clear, saying Iraq is important, Afghanistan is important, but the key issue for the Middle East and for the entire world is the nuclearization, the possible nuclearization of Iran. And this should be handled before anything else. So I won't be surprised if the new president of America in a few months' time will become very tough, either taking action, military action, or alternatively, and this might help, giving the Iranian very clear, reliable, and unreversible military ultimatum. Let me remind you that in 2003, the Iranian did postpone for a year and a half their nuclear enrichment program because it was immediately after the American invasion of Iraq.
Who've hijacked a ship carrying weapons off the coast of Somalia are vowing to fight to the death. They're being closely watched by the U.S. Navy and a Russian warship, which is also on its way. As Dan Nolan reports, the pirates are denying reports. They've been fighting amongst themselves.
This is the first video of the hijacked Ukrainian vessel creating an international dilemma off the coast of Somalia. It was filmed by crew members of the U.S. warship that's been eyeballing the MV Vena for several days. In addition to the 20 crew members being held hostage, is a military shipment that, according to the Pentagon, is bigger than first thought.
This particular vessel, the Vena, has on it a number of Russian tanks and ammo and RPGs and anti-aircraft weapons that raise this to yet another level of concern.
The pirates are demanding a ransom of $20 million and say they'll fight to the death if an operation is launched to free the ship. A man claiming to be the leader of the 30 pirates on board has denied reports of a shootout between his own men that allegedly killed three of them. He claims his crew are more like a coast guard than pirates, as their aim is to stop illegal fishing and dumping in Somali waters. US officials say they've allowed the pirates to resupply the ship with food and water, but not to unload any of its military cargo, which they now agree was on its way to Kenya, not Sudan.
What we're concerned about now is it's not in the control of those people who intended to deliver it to the government of Kenya. It's now in the control of pirates to whom we do not know they will sell this material.
The U.S. fears the armaments may end up with Islamic courts fighters who have been waging an insurgency against the shaky UN-backed Somali transitional government since late 2006. The tanks on board are Soviet-type T-72s, similar to those used by Russia to invade Georgia. With Russian crew members also being held hostage, Moscow has sent a warship which should arrive in the coming days. Whether it will attempt a rescue remains to be seen, but Pentagon officials say they're confident the US and Russian navies will be able to work together. Dan Nolan, Al Jazeera.
The press in Egypt is facing a real dilemma as it confronts punishments that harm freedom. This special report by our colleague Muna Ashmawi.
The court sentenced journalist Ibrahim Issa, the editor-in-chief of Al Dastur newspaper, to 2 months in jail for the widely reported case of publishing false news and rumors about the health of the president. The sentence provoked major condemnation and mobilization among journalists and media professionals. A large number of journalists, media professionals, and dozens of youth demonstrated, dubbing themselves the April 6th movement. There were also many members of the parliament.
Today we are asking the Attorney General to put an injunction on this sentence based on the motion submitted by the lawyer for Ibrahim Issa and the Journalists Guild. A similar incident happened with Mustafa al-Bakri many years ago. He was sentenced to 3 or 4 years in jail, but the sentence was not implemented. Everyone believes that the citizens' rights in Egypt are being lost.
The Egyptian press is experiencing a real dilemma and a huge crisis. The case does not deserve such a sentence. Ibrahim Issa wrote about the poor health of the president, since the president is more than 80 years old. The government could have responded by saying that the president's health is good and concluded this matter. However, jailing Ibrahim Issa because he wrote about the president's health exposes the police state that is governing us.
This is an unjust sentence because it is not acceptable at all for any journalist or any citizen to go to jail because he spreads news, writes something, or expresses his opinion. In a country as large as Egypt, it is not beneficial to still have punishments that harm our freedoms.
Ibrahim Issa's sentence is the continuation of the policy and direction that the government took a long time ago against the freedom of speech and against journalists in general. It is also the continuation of the sentence against Majid Hussein, the editor-in-chief of Al-Shaab newspaper, the sentence against Ayman Nur, the sentence against Musa Abu Fagr, and the sentences that came out against many opinion writers. It is also a continuation of the policy of closing many newspapers like Al-Shaab newspaper and others that were closed during Mubarak's term. We as Young Egyptians, or the April 6th movement, view the continuation of these sentences and state policies that restrict freedom of the press and the freedom of speech as a catastrophe.
Ibrahim's case, which has been heard in the courts for nearly a year, was postponed and resumed many times. Thus, Issa's lawyer says that the jail sentence will not be carried out because the Journalists' Union will forcefully stand against it.
This is an appellate ruling, so of course there is nothing we can do except take it to the next legal level, and that is to appeal. We will appeal the sentence. Of course, in order to make an appeal, Ibrahim must be in jail while the appeal is being heard. However, I want to assure the journalists and ordinary citizens that the case has affected public opinion. There are 2 points in the law that we used and we have been using always. In Mr. Ibrahim's defense, he has the right to reject the sentence and request an injunction until the appellate court has its say. The jailing of Ibrahim Issa will shock public opinion, and there will be a huge regression in the freedom of the press, which we are fighting against. We are demanding more freedoms.
The crisis of the freedom of the press and media will not be the first or the last, as the fourth authority is gradually being transformed into an authority with its hands tied, which writes, publishes, and broadcasts what the government and the ruling party says. In fact, Ibrahim's case, from the start, is a lawsuit filed by a member of the National Party, who claims to be concerned about the security, safety, and the government. But they themselves are the reasons for all the criticisms that are made against the government and the courts by taking hypocritical actions that have nothing to do with democracy and logical development of the world. Ibrahim Issa will not go to jail. This is what his defense attorney has confirmed. However, questions remain. Will Egyptian journalists remain threatened by the boogeyman known as jail and fines? And how long will freedom of speech and freedom of the press remain in a real crisis? Muna Ashmawi, New TV, Cairo.
Several Arab and Islamic countries celebrated today the first day of Eid al-Fitr holiday. In Syria, Egypt, India, and Pakistan, Muslims started to celebrate the Eid during early morning hours. They held sermons and prayers at the mosques and the open plazas specially reserved for Eid. Pakistan was among the Muslim nations that celebrated Eid al-Fitr holiday today. Pakistanis ignored their political, security, and economic problems and focused their attention on the blessed holiday. They welcomed and celebrated Eid in a historical and cultural fashion. Meanwhile, henna and bracelets, especially the glass bangles, are among the most popular Eid items favored by Pakistani women. To Pakistani women, the joy of Eid will not be complete without wearing a glass bangle around their wrists. Mayub Kuder reports from Islamabad.
To Pakistani women, the eyes are faster than the hands when it comes to glass bangles, which are not made of gold or pearl. They are bracelets of Eid, which add to the beauty of Pakistani women during the holiday. The glass bangles with their different colors and shapes hit Pakistani markets in large numbers, especially during the last 10 days of the holy month of Ramadan, when demand is at its highest peak.
Wearing bracelets during Eid is an old Pakistani tradition. We have been accustomed to it since we were young. The bangles are a source of happiness and look nice on women.
The glass bangles shine as they were embedded with a rare type of sacred stones. Their beauty attracts the eyes before one even thinks about buying them. And to the children, the scenario doesn't change much. Eid is not a holiday without a bracelet.
We pick the colors of glass bangles that match our clothes. The bracelets are a better alternative to gold and silver, and sometimes they look more attractive.
The trading of glass bangles during the last day of Ramadan is a seasonal business, brought to Pakistan by way of tradition and custom. However, many in Pakistan try to reap its benefits.
I buy bracelets from Karachi and sell them here. The business lasts only 2 weeks, in which I earn 40,000 Pakistani rupees.
Moreover, the joy of Eid is not complete without henna, which Pakistani women love dearly, even if they have to sit on the street sidewalks and wait for it. Although henna doesn't last long, Pakistani women will not enjoy Eid without it. Along with henna, the glass bangles bring joy and happiness to the hearts of Pakistani women and girls, a joy that far offsets the simplicity and cheap cost involved in the manufacturing of such products. Mayub Kuder, Dubai TV, Islamabad.
Get more news about the Middle East online at linktv.org/mosaic. The Mosaic webpage offers a complete archive of Mosaic programs, program transcripts, the Mosaic Video Podcast, and the Mosaic Intelligence Report, a weekly analysis of the hottest stories from the Middle East. The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible with the support of viewers like you. Thank you. This program was brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. television network devoted to global and national news with uncompromising documentaries and diverse cultural programs. Programs which connect you to the world.